Hello, and welcome to the latest installment of A Communion of Subjects, Law, Environment, and Religion, brought to you from three Yale University schools, Law, Divinity, and Forestry. Our guest today is the Most Reverend Katharine Jefferts Schori, Bishop and Biologist. My name is Nathan Ipsel. I'm one of your two co-hosts today. I'm a political organizer and Episcopal Seminarian at Yale Divinity School and the Yale School of Forestry and Environmental Studies.
And I'm Samantha, a student at Yale Law School. Before our guest became known to the world as the Presiding Bishop of the Episcopal Church, she was Dr. Katharine Jefferts Schori, a research scientist with a PhD in oceanography, focusing on squid in the Pacific Ocean. She became an Episcopal priest in 1994, working as a pastor, university lecturer, and hospice chaplain in Oregon, and was ordained the Bishop of Nevada in 2001. Bishop Katharine was elected presiding bishop in 2005, chief pastor to roughly 2 million Episcopalians, the first woman to ever hold such a position in the global Anglican Communion. She is the author of multiple books, including The Heartbeat of God, Finding the Sacred in the Middle of Everything.
Bishop, thank you for being here.
You're welcome.
Your term as presiding bishop ended in late 2015, and I've been wondering ever since, what are you up to?
Well, last year I taught at the Divinity School in Virginia, the Episcopal one, in the spring semester, and in the fall semester I taught at the Episcopal Seminary in Berkeley, California.
What were you teaching?
At Virginia, I taught a course basically about what church leaders need to know about science. Conversation between religion and science in a number of different areas, and a second course about peacemaking and spiritual discipline. At CDSP in Berkeley, I taught a course about engaging the public square, science being a portion of that.
Peacemaking and spiritual discipline?
Yes. Spiritual discipline is about a way of shaping your worldview and your daily practice so that you might become, in the peacemaking sense, so that you might become a more effective reconciler.
Did any of these courses have an environmental element to them?
Yes, they all did, one way or another.
That does not surprise me. You have long been outspoken in a good way on climate change and environmental stewardship. I know in 2015 you told one conference that the motivations behind climate change, political interest, willful blindness are sinful. And you said in 2008 at a conference in Salt Lake City, all of Scripture's language about the body of Christ applies equally to the body of God's creation. I think that brings us to what can seem like a simple question, but is one that many Christians haven't thought of. What does Christianity have to say about the environment and environmental ethics in the 21st century?
A great deal. The basic command of Jesus, it echoes what is said in the Hebrew Scriptures as well, that our task as faithful human beings is to love God with all we are and have, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. It's about building a world of just relationships, just in the sense of justice. And if we fail to care for the earth and its structures and members in faithful ways, we're not caring for our human neighbors either.
You just used a phrase, just relationships. Mm-hmm. You've often spoken about just relationships, holy relationships, or right relationships with God, with one another, and with the earth. Could you unpack that phrase a little bit? What does right relationship look like?
Right relationship means acknowledging the essence and the right to life, in some sense, of the other partner in the relationship, whether human or non-human. Recognizing the origin of that partner in relationship as being shared with all the rest of creation in a religious sense, that we are equally brothers and sisters, members of the same community of life. Just relationships are ones that honor the potential of another creature, that honor the ability of other creatures to seek the fullness of life for which they were created.
How do we balance that? When are there times when loving our human neighbor may seem to clash with the potential of a non-human creature? Where's the balance in those situations?
To be discerned in the midst of context, not always easily. I think the big political fights we have are about where that balance lies.
It sounds like you do see intrinsic value in nature.
Yes. People of the Abrahamic traditions would acknowledge that all of what is, in some sense, reflects its origin. Creation by God. We routinely say that about human beings. We have not always affirmed that when it comes to non-human creation. But the theology would lead us in the very same direction.
Could you say a bit more about that theology? When did it begin? Where in the scriptures is it rooted? Or what theologians can people look to for more info?
Well, Christians would look to Genesis, to the two stories of creation in Genesis. The first one, God creates light and dark, separates light from darkness, each of 6 days of the week. Comes to the end of the week and God rests for a day, creates holy rest in some sense. At the end of each day of creation, God says, this is good. This is good. The implication is it reflects the divine being. Come to the end of the week of creation, human beings are created, and God said, it is very good. Blesses all of it. A second creation story is about Adam and Eve and the garden and what goes wrong.
It's interesting that you point to Genesis. I know for many, when they think of Genesis and the environment, the word that comes up is dominion. But you've said some interesting things in your work about the linguistic roots of dominion.
Mm-hmm. Dominion comes from the Latin word for house, domus, domicile, domestic. And if you go in that direction, you can affirm that dominion is about housekeeping and husbanding. It's about caring for the members of the household, that God has given us. Mm-hmm. Some sense.
Caring for the members of the household. That, I like that. That reminds me of the focus in your work on the Millennium Development Goals and the role that poverty played in those. You've said before in the Diocese of New York's Hobart Lecture that when communities begin to dig into pastoral issues, they discover the connections between food and justice, environment, and poverty. Mm-hmm. What are those connections between the environment, poverty, race, and why are they pastoral?
I'm going to do another linguistic thing on you. Pastoral comes from the word for pasture, grass. Pastoral care is about caring for the pasture as well as the people who depend on the pasture. If the sheep don't have enough to eat, there's something wrong with the pasture or the pastoral care of the sheep. Who is most affected by environmental issues in the world today? It's usually the poorest, the people without voice, the people without political access or political agency. Therefore, the concern of the church in particular should be for the least. Jesus himself says, you take care of the least and the lost and the left out, and you will be members of the kingdom of God. If you ignore them, forget it.
That reminds me, just a few minutes ago, talking about the balance of living, you know, helping the least of these with the non-human elements of creation. Mm-hmm. Talking about right relationship at a lunch with divinity school students today, you said that right relationship can be about loving your neighbor as yourself. So a related question would be, if we are to live in right relationship with the earth and the non-human elements of creation, are we to love animals and the earth as ourselves?
I think we're meant to respect the origin of animals and the earth. We are to love them in ways that are appropriate to their being. If you're in a romantic relationship, you don't love someone, you don't ideally strive to love someone only as the way you want to be loved. You want to love them as the way they want to be loved, that person wants to be loved. You want to respect their difference. You want to respect their particular gifts and not simply impose your own on that person.
So what does that look like? How do plants and animals want to be loved?
Freedom, I think. The ability to flourish in the way they were created to flourish. If we want to be particular, one doesn't plant corn seeds in weather like this. They won't grow. They won't thrive. You have to wait until the soil is warmer and the weather is more auspicious for their appropriate development. You know, I can remember seeing a banana plant in a barrel on the street of Manhattan in the middle of January. It didn't look very happy.
So what, when we do practice these right relationships with plants, with the poor, with animals, mm-hmm. what happens?
That vision of what happens, what might happen, is called in Hebrew shalom, called the kingdom of God in Christian tradition. It's a vision of a world that is flourishing because the elements of that community, that earth community, are treated appropriately. Human beings aren't attempting to harvest every last bit of corn for their own personal use, but to leave some for other creatures, to see that the world is maintained in some semblance of balance.
Unfortunately, there are times we do take that last kernel mm-hmm. of corn. You've spoken out against this kind of thing. You're not the first religious leader. Pope Francis, since your mm-hmm. return, put out Laudato Si. Mm-hmm. Interfaith Power and Light is a nonprofit mm-hmm. doing amazing work on this. And yet, for all the work that I see going on at the level of your leadership and in national denominations, the Pew Research Center has said that only 22% of churchgoers say they hear about the environment in their mm-hmm. congregation. And other research says that's even true of progressive denominations like our own Episcopal Church. Have you seen that kind of a split between the national and the local?
I'm seeing a significant shift on the local, in the local congregations. More and more, for example, are planting gardens mm-hmm. to help feed the neighborhood, to remove the lawns that are mostly resource sinks rather than productive. I mentioned this earlier, but there's a congregation outside of Washington, D.C. that has adopted a watershed and sees that as part of their pastoral care of the community, caring for the creatures and the elements of that watershed that allow the lives of many kinds of creatures to flourish. Awareness is growing, not fast enough, but mm-hmm. it is growing.
Why isn't it growing faster?
Well, the theological response might be sin. sin in the sense of self-interest and only self-interest. If we are only self-focused, we don't flourish either. It is the focus on the flourishing of the whole community that allows everyone to flourish.
How can we begin to widen that lens and not focus just on ourselves anymore?
Well, I'd go back to spiritual discipline. We stand at the beginning of Lent, which in the Christian tradition is an invitation to examine our lives and how we respond to our neighbors of all sorts. It's an opportunity to listen more deeply to the lament and the joys of people and other creatures around us. It's an opportunity to redirect our energies and our resources toward more productive and life-giving ends.
Life-giving ends.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to shift gears a little bit, or maybe not, and talk about the church's role in society. So we're in an era of distrust in institutions as well as declining church membership. What can the church do to stay relevant to broader society given those forces?
I think the church's primary responsibility has always been to be a member of a community, to be present in the community and not simply, again, self-focused. Congregations and religious communities that are engaged in the life of the wider community tend to be healthier, tend to be more life-giving, more creative in the deep sense of that word. And I think that is the journey that more religious communities are focusing on today.
Could you provide some examples of what being engaged in the community as a church would look like? Mm-hmm.
The engagement adopting a watershed is one, but being present in ways that address the particular needs of a community. I know that a couple of denominational structures in New England have in the last decade begun to deal with redundant buildings, buildings that they really no longer need for mm-hmm. religious purposes. And they've listened in the wider community to see what the wider community might view as a potential use for that building. And they've had some very creative results. It's a form of community organizing, if you mm-hmm. will, to listen deeply to what's going on here. Congregations that do that are become relevant.
Wonderful. And going off the idea of community engagement and being involved in the wider needs of the community, in 2008 you testified to Congress on the issue of climate change. That year you also noted in the Hobart lecture that politics as pastoralia. How do you see the church's role in the political process?
The political process, I think, is the art of living together in community. And it's the art of resolving or wrestling with the tension between competing needs, or what are perceived as competing mm-hmm. needs. Do we decide on behalf of this threatened species? Do we decide on behalf of the poor people who live in this neighborhood? Does it have to be either or? How can we find a constructive compromise? Spanish has two words for politics, política, which means politics, and politiquería, which means dirty politics. We need politics. Jesus was a political animal. He understood the need to find a balance and to challenge people who only were willing to see one perspective. When we can do it with a goal of finding a synergy, a new creative outcome that is larger or more constructive than either of the positions that might be wrestled with, then I think we're doing the kind of work we need to be doing.
Wonderful. Many pastors don't necessarily share your sentiment, partially because they're terrified that any political advocacy would violate the separation of church and state. How do we reassure them that they can go beyond just changing the light bulbs and advocate for systematic change?
I think it's at the root of what religious communities are for. Mm-hmm. Religious communities have a vision of a better world, a world where people can live together in peace with justice. I look around, I don't see that we're quite there yet. Most religious leaders would agree with that. Most people of good faith would agree with that. So the challenge is, where are we going to engage for the purpose of transformation? Mm-hmm. That's an organizing challenge, but it's also a networking challenge. How do we connect with the wider voices in this community, the wider actors in this community? How do we help to create a sense of agency among people who think there's no possibility of change? How do we equip and empower people who haven't acted in this way before? There is a better world. There is possibility for something that doesn't look so cutthroat or selfish. What's our role in helping to make that a reality?
What is our role in helping to make that a reality?
Yes.
Well, I think that's why you're all here. I think our role is to learn as much as we can and to help educate others. I think our role is to voice what we see. Our role is to stay in conversation. Conversation is a perhaps less honored word than it needs to be. It means to be in community together. You know, when it came into English around the year 1300, it didn't mean to throw words at one another. It meant to spend time in the way you're doing in this class. So much so that there's a technical term in English law called criminal conversation. You can probably tell us what it is.
You will.
It means adultery. It's spending too much time with the wrong person. But it brings a sense of the deeply intimate community that conversation is meant to build. The word conversion comes from the same root. When we spend enough time in deep community with people, we might be shifted to a different viewpoint. Both of us, all of us, in the midst of community. And there's really no possibility of that without spending the time.
And going off the idea of spending the time, how can the church do that? I know it's often quoted that the most segregated hour is high noon on Sunday. And we tend to organize into very like-minded communities mm-hmm. within the church. Mm-hmm. How can we reach new people, new voices, and create that real conversation?
Well, at the end of many Christian services today, there's something that's usually called a dismissal. It says, go out and do the work that God's given you to do. That's where it needs to happen. We need to not stay within our like-minded communities, only talking to people who agree with us. That's ultimately not creative. It's stifling. Unless there is some fresh air in the room, unless there is some tension, growth's not possible. Transformation's not possible. Our role as faithful people is that transforming work in the world. It's not easy. It's not always comfortable. But it's the only source of new life in the world around us.
Yeah, and engaging with lots of social activism, the church has had a checkered history. The church has done really great things, and at the same time, mm-hmm. it's also failed to mm-hmm. live up to a lot of its mm-hmm. ideals. How do we do that kind of conversation, that community organizing in a thoughtful way that acknowledges the history, mm-hmm. while also acknowledges the power of the church to reach new people mm-hmm. and really inspire others?
The Christian tradition has a word for that. It's called repentance. It literally it means turning around. Mm-hmm. Like conversion, it's turning in a new direction. It's acknowledging the fact that you did not have the fullness of the truth you thought you had, that you did something wrong. And that you are searching for that new creative possibility mm-hmm. in a new direction in conversation with other perspectives.
When we talk about recognizing that you don't have the full truth, I think the first thing I ever heard you say was we need to learn to hold our truths lightly. Mm-hmm. You talk about the importance of listening and being in deep community. Are there examples from your life or your career where you were changed because of listening to others?
Absolutely. I think in the midst of the controversy while I was presiding bishop, particularly over the place of LGBT people in the church, beginning to hear some of the fear from people on all sides of the challenge. When people are willing to be able to be honest enough to acknowledge that they're afraid of something, change is possible. Change is possible. I think that's what's happened in this country over the last decade. Everybody has become aware that I have a gay friend or a lesbian coworker or there's a transgender person down the street. When you know someone, when you've spent time in that kind of conversation, your own attitudes can begin to shift.
So whether it's sexuality or climate denial, fear mm-hmm. of what a climate mm-hmm. policy might mm-hmm. look like, getting rid of a redundant building, but we've always had this building and I love mm-hmm. it so much. Yep. Mm-hmm. When someone is in that fear, how do you draw them lovingly to the table?
Sitting with them. I think simply accompanying someone in the midst of that kind of fear, we all have it at various times. The presence of somebody, you know, as a kid said once, God with skin on, walking with you, can make a remarkable difference.
God with skin on?
God with skin on. Yeah. Not an ethereal idea, but God with skin on. The image of God in human flesh.
That reminds me of something you said at the lunch earlier today that we should bring up here. We see God in one another, people mm-hmm. created in the image mm-hmm. of God, but, and I want to shift to talk about religion and science, so maybe this mm-hmm. is a good entree to that. What about seeing the Creator in his or in God's creation?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Judeo-Christian tradition is very clear about the belief that every human being bears the image of God. One of the gifts of that is the realization that when we see difference, we see something new about God, about the Creator. It's not been explored as thoroughly as it needs to be in terms of the wider creation, but how in the world can a faithful person say that an omnipotent Creator creates things that don't bear the divine image? Everything that is must in some way reflect its origin. And Christians in particular have work to do in terms of probing the depths of that. But the ivy outside, the birds in the sky, in some way bear a reflection of the one, the force who has created that.
Christians have more work to do in probing that. Could you say more about that?
I think because we've abused our status as human beings. We have said that we sit at the crown of creation. We are the end point of creation. Well, I look around and I think we've got a long way to go yet. We have a great deal to learn from the rest of creation. You know, Job says, learn from the beasts, learn from the creatures. Jesus uses natural examples in his teaching. He said, well, look at the birds of the sky and the flowers of the field. They're not anxious. Why are you anxious?
It sounds like maybe humanity listening to Job needs to decenter ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Can we do that and still maintain the theologies of Aquinas or other Christian traditions that say this was created for humans, or do we need to move away from that part of our tradition?
Tradition is always in the process of reinterpreting itself, if it's a faithful, growing, living tradition. We Christians often say this is the living Word of God, Scripture is the living Word of God. Well, if it's not self-critical, if it's not examined again, yet again, in the context of new realities, then it's not alive. Some of our forebears have been wrong, just flat out wrong. You know, Christians said slavery was right because it's recognized in the Bible. Christians have said polygamy is wrong even though it's mentioned in the Bible. We come to different conclusions in different contexts and different times. If we're faithful, we're continually re-examining what it is we have held as centrally true. And it's a tension. It's never black and white, absolutely clear, but it's a tension, and it's a constructive tension, can be a constructive tension.
I think being able to say that, to look at our history and say our forebears got it wrong sometimes, that takes guts.
Well, I believe it's true.
Absolutely.
And community consensus has judged it to be true.
I want to back up just a little and go back to what you said about seeing the divine image in creation. As Samantha noted at the mm-hmm. beginning, before you ordained a priest, you were a practicing research scientist, a marine biologist. Did you see the divine image through the scientific method?
Absolutely. The wonder of creation, I think, is what drew me into science. It's also what continues to draw me closer to God, the mystery. I didn't get a lot of help when I was growing up in terms of helping science and religion talk to one another. And it really wasn't until I was in graduate school and reading the great physicists of the early 20th century who talk about mystery, you know, Heisenberg and Bohr and Einstein. they didn't know everything. They saw things that were mysterious, and that's really what drew them into the depths of their creative inquiry.
Mystery. Can you say a bit more about mystery?
There are, in opposition to one biblical source, there are new things under the sun. things we haven't discovered or understood yet, and I think that's what draws all of you to this kind of work. That's what draws scientists as well as people of faith into greater and deeper inquiry.
Mystery scares some people.
Oh, well, it's also fascinating. Rudolf Otto said that religion was mysterium tremendum et fascinans, the great and fascinating mystery, the awesome one in the sense of when the Bible is often translated as the fear of God, it's talking about the awe at the presence of God. Yes, it can frighten people because it can be overwhelming, but it's also what keeps us connected. What is romantic love about? It's about the mystery of another person, right? It's fascinating, and at times it's terrifying because it seems so different.
It's fascinating to, setting aside romantic love, okay. It's fascinating to hear you quote Einstein about God and to remember that Darwin also talked about God. What is the relationship, for you at least, between religion and science?
There are different ways of looking at the world. They're like different lenses. Your eyes might have one eye that sees at the distance well and another eye that you use more effectively for reading. Well, I think religion and science are something like that. They use similar methods and processes, even though we don't often recognize that. They're wisdom communities who pass on the best of what they've learned from the past to new generations with the consensus of a community. They test hypotheses, and the ones that seem reasonable are continued, and the ones that aren't get rejected. There's standards for behavior in the community, not always well addressed, but there are standards. and the community holds people to account.
Well, this might fall in the bucket of rejecting some things or our forebears being wrong, but when a religious text or even, well, we covered doctrine, when a religious mm-hmm. text in scripture clashes with a scientific discovery, whether that's fights over evolution or the sun standing still mm-hmm. in the book of Joshua, mm-hmm. how can we navigate those tensions and still retain some meaning in our scripture and know what to believe?
I think it's really helpful to focus on what scripture intends to teach and transmit, what the tradition is about. And it's not always identical to what science is trying to teach. Part of the difficulty with the Enlightenment was that it encouraged people to see them as the same thing, and they're not. Religious texts are about teaching a particular kind of wisdom about how to live a good life. Scientific texts are about teaching how the world works. There's this great phrase that religion is about how to go to heaven, and science is about how the heavens go. Copernicus, Galileo. They're asking different questions. And when we confuse what the questions are, then we get a bit muddled. But when we can use the lenses appropriately, we have a much richer perspective on the world, a much better depth perception, if you will.
Lenses.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't want to confuse the two lenses, but knowing that they're separate yet looking at the same thing,
mm-hmm.
what is something you learned as a scientist that surprised you about your faith or about religion? And what is something you later learned as a priest or bishop that surprised you about science?
I think the cosmological questions are probably the most fascinating. Origins of the universe. science doesn't have an ultimate answer as to why or how yet. It may never. But the congruities, if you're willing to look with different lenses, about a, they're fascinating. I think the work about of ecosystems, understanding the world as and creation as intimately connected, that no one piece can act individually without affecting all the other pieces. And that's something that can be learned from both lenses, but in different ways.
So, as Nathan was talking about the connection between science and religion in the abstract, but I wanted to talk a little bit about how about the people involved in science and religion. You gave a speech at MIT on the social responsibility of a scientist, presenting this ethical message: none of us can hide behind the technical work and leave the ethical work to others. It requires a partnership. Have scientists been receptive to this ethical message?
At times. I think about the challenges around developing the hydrogen bomb, the atomic bomb. Some scientists opted out of those projects. Others didn't engage the ethical questions. They said, well, that's not my problem. That's for somebody else to worry about. I think whole human beings, whatever discipline they labor in, have to begin to bring together the ethical consequences of their actions if they're going to be whole. That makes some sense. How you apply the law in the interests of justice, which is what it's about, the law can be manipulated for unjust ends, sometimes is. Science can be manipulated for ends that aren't life-giving.
And going off that, have you noticed an issue with church members being receptive to your environmental message? So kind of turning the question around.
I think faithful human beings are open often at some level to a conversion experience, to the challenge to their own perspective that, well, I don't have to worry about this because, you know, I'm 80 years old and it's not going to affect me. Mm-hmm. Well, it is going to affect your children and your grandchildren. How you live today impacts the ability of people across the globe to grow food, to have clean water, to have some expectation of better education for their children. We are connected. The center of the religious message is that we are bound up with one another. Our lives depend on one another. Science teaches the same kinds of things, but not always with the ethical imperative that how I live here today is important because it impacts other people and not just myself.
With the church perspective, one of the real strengths of religion and the church in particular is that it can provide hope. So much of the environmental movement feels very doom and gloom. You hear about what's going to happen if we don't do this, and we're moving too slowly. And it can feel really hopeless sometimes. What gives you hope?
The fact that people are awakening. The fellow who drove me from the airport last night said, it's getting warmer here. The weather's changing. I'm worried about my children and what this planet is going to be like for them. Not evidently a person of overt religious faith, but he's aware and he's concerned. Being able to voice that lament is the first stage in changing something. If the world doesn't seem right, if something's wrong in your life, in the community in which you live, maybe you're motivated to change something. The Christian message, the religious message, I think, of all great world religions, is a sense of hope, that more is possible than any one of us can see at the moment. In Christian theology, we say that God is ultimately the source of all life, and that as dismal as it may seem to me today, there is more life in the midst of this than I can yet recognize. There is always possibility. There is always hope. That's what resurrection is about.
Are there ways in which that hope is perhaps even a political message?
Absolutely. If there's no possibility of change, why should I do anything? It's intrinsic to the transformative work of community organizing, of politics in the basic sense of the word, in terms of community engagement, in terms of living a whole life as a human being.
Listening to you say that reminds me of some of the work of Shane Claiborne or William Barber, who talk about how love and loving your enemy, as Jesus says, can be a destabilizing force.
Absolutely.
Hope seems like maybe it can not just give us strength, but destabilize cynicism.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. There's a wonderful passage that we had in the readings in church quite recently that talked about turning the other cheek and going the second mile. It's a hopeful response to something that looks absolutely hopeless. In the ancient world, if a master hit a slave, it would have been like this. Well, if the slave turned his or her head and looked the guy in the eye and invited him to do it again, well, he'd have to use the open part of his hand. He couldn't use the other hand. It's for unclean purposes. He has to look the person in the eye. And doing this is the action of an equal. It has subverted the master-slave relationship. It has exposed the offender to the image of God in the person in front of him. That's a very destabilizing act. The civil rights movement is based on action like that. It says, I'm a human being and I'm not going away. Deal with it.
And that verse about if someone hits you in the right cheek, turn the left also, that continues with the Roman impressment and destabilize the courts,
all in
three powerful verses.
Right.
Like you said earlier, Jesus knew the political system.
Absolutely.
Two final questions for you. Thank you so much for being here today.
Oh.
45 minutes is not a lot of time. If anyone watching feels inspired to go learn more about the three big buckets we've covered, Christianity and the environment, religion and science, the church and society, where would you suggest they look? Books, authors, NGOs, anything. Where can people learn more?
Oh, there are myriad of resources. That's the challenge, where to focus. Story of the universe. Talk about religion and science, I think, in one package.
Journey of the universe?
Thank you.
Sorry.
Thank you very much.
Just want to be sure people Google the right thing.
Right.
Sorry.
I think in your local community, exploring the resources that are available right here in your local environment, if you're watching this. If you're a scientist, I gather that the AAAS had a remarkable meeting recently talking about these kinds of issues.
AAAS?
What did I say?
I don't know what that stands for.
Oh, American Academy for the American Association for the Advancement of Science. Pardon me. Academics are beginning to have these conversations across disciplines. The educational environment is increasingly moving toward transdisciplinary opportunities for the destabilizing kinds of possibilities. I think it gives everybody hope to look more deeply from another perspective into their own.
Thank you again for being here. I just wanted to kind of give you an opportunity to say something that you think our viewers would like to hear that we didn't ask.
I think we can learn from the younger people around us. Children in school learn a great deal about the plight of the planet, and they're often the converters of their elders. The work and the learning that you are doing in this course, I think, is an example to the people who will see this online. It's possible to learn to see from another perspective and to discover the creativity that comes with that. You give hope to all who recognize what's going on in the midst of this class, and I give thanks for that.
Thank you so much for being here.
Earlier you mentioned dismissal coming at the end of liturgy. Mm. Could I ask you to dismiss us?
Go in peace to serve the life of this planet and this universe.
Thank you.
Thanks, thank you.